All right, guys, landed in the Netherlands, finally. It's been a long day of travel. I'm here in my rental car, and now we're gonna drive to the police dog center in Holland. And we're gonna take a look at some of the dogs that they have available. We're running a little bit late today, and this is gonna be my first time actually driving a car in Europe. So these people drive on the wrong side of the road, so it's gonna be interesting. But at least they're in kilometers, so we have that much in common. So I'll check back in with you guys soon. Alright guys, I know I said I need to focus on the road, but I guess I was wrong. These people drive on the same side as Canadians do, so maybe it's the Brits that drive on the wrong side of the road.
Please keep left and follow the A9.
But so far, this is like exactly like Canada. Everything is the same. Even the shrubbery, it's a little bit flatter than Ontario. It's more like a mixture. It's like a more kind of lush version of I would say, Alberta.
Left.
But yeah, it's quite easy to drive here, which is nice. So anyways, we are on the route, and so far everything's looking good. Not a fan of the Volvo, I gotta say. This is like a Honda. They said SUV. I did not realize that meant basically a slightly lifted four-door sedan with like no trunk space. So I guess SUV is a bit of a stretch. But I screwed up on my rental booking. I thought I was getting an Audi, instead I get a Volvo. But small problems, first world problems, as they say. One thing I was really impressed with was that they have a lot of employees here that have been here for quite a few years, and employee retention is never an easy thing. So I was very impressed with that. Tells me that they're a good company. They treat their people well. They also had a guy. They have some foreign employees, people from like foreign police forces and stuff that they hire to run their classes. They had a class here from Africa, doing narcotics, like a 12-week narcotics course. So it's a really nice, big facility. So I'm gonna take you guys around the facility a little bit, show you around. They always have these kind of vans and trailers parked all over with dogs coming in for x-rays. These dogs are all here for x-rays. You guys can see a couple of them. I try not to disturb them too much. Oh, he just had his x-rays. Or he's next. So they always have horses. That's one thing I noticed about this place, is there's horses everywhere, and really nice horses. Apparently this area is known for their sport horses. So I assume these are all like Dutch warm bloods. There's a mare with her baby over there. Really nice horses, like all very well taken care of. Everywhere I go, I see them. So let's go inside. I'm gonna show you guys some of the stuff that they've got going on here. And don't worry, those dogs do not live. Dogs don't live in this. These are just quick holding pens so that they can put dogs in there between work. They've got like a fake, well, it's not fake, it's a real baggage conveyor belt. They've got, you know, some upper, this is the shipping bay. So these are where the dogs are shipped out of. They go into crates and then they go in the van and then straight to the airport to whatever destination they're going to. I love using these stairs. So these are stairs that are excellent. I mean, I'm sure it's just a functional set of stairs, but at the second I saw this, I made every dog I selected go up and down these stairs. They've got a little lounge up here, which is nice. Some rooms, I think, for people to stay in even. So I made all the dogs go up and down these stairs because, in my opinion, if a dog can do these, even half-ass do them, like, you know, especially the dogs. Like, all the dogs here are very green. They're about a year to 2 years old. Usually it's a year. Those types of stairs, especially if the dog hasn't seen it before, it's going to be very scary, very difficult. So I'm looking for a dog can do it, go up, go down, and then go up and go down. And I'm looking for the second time the dog does it to be better. And that's the big thing. So you got all sorts of training rooms in here. I'll take you guys to the kennel shortly. All right, guys, they have a vet clinic here. So I'm going to take you guys to the vet clinic where they do all the x-rays on site, which is extremely useful and handy. There's no taking the dogs all the way to the vet. So they do all the x-rays on site here. They have their little holding pens. They got a floppy in here, little lab. Not a little one, he's a big boy. And they do all the x-rays in here. I assume that this might be locked. Nope, it's not. So you can see they've got a whole clinic set up. They x-ray the dogs. It takes them about 5 minutes to x-ray each dog. So vets in Canada should take note from that. And these guys are, I watch them position, I mean, I've been through a few x-rays by now. These guys are fast. They just position the dog, they catch the x-ray. It's very quick, it's very efficient. I love it. So, you know, we have the x-rays within 5 minutes for each dog. You know, you can't complain with that.
First. Oh yeah. Let's. Sydney. Okay.
Shake it. Shake it. Shake it. Shake it. Shake
it. Shake it. He changed his name. Really nice family dog. Or maybe police dog. He can kind of go both directions. He has a really nice drive. He's here with Lars. Lars is one of the top trainers here at Police Dogs. Lars has been helping me the whole time I was here. He's a great guy to deal with. So if you come here, you talk to Lars. Okay, so this is Asap, guys. He comes from the Czech Republic and he comes through Police Dog Center Holland. And we're very excited to bring him back to Canada. He's going to be a very fun addition to our program. I'm still not sure whether we're gonna do he's one of those dogs can go both ways. He can do police work, he can do protection work. He's a very stable dog and he has all the qualities we look for: the drive, the confidence, the looks. Beautiful dog. You know, unfortunately Lars isn't as beautiful as the dog, but this is what it is.
Shipping department, they got everything, like literally everything. These guys are 24 hours. You know, like they're literally selling dogs all over the world all the time, and they're training, they're doing everything. So it's a really fantastic facility. Now, as usual, when you see tons of dogs, listen, I'm very, very specific with what I'm looking for, especially when it comes to a dual purpose dog. So I said, let's start with the dual purpose dogs because that's really their specialty. Let's see what they have that they consider to be dual-purpose dogs. I said, give me German Shepherds. I like German Shepherds. I think German Shepherds are generally a better dog to deal in. Not that there's a problem with Mallees or Dutchies, but just typically they tend to be a little bit more stable, a little bit more forgiving for the handler. You know, I find them a little bit of a safer dog to deal in and to sell and, you know, so on and so forth. Now, that being said, a strong dog is a strong dog. So he shows me one German Shepherd, first German Shepherd that comes out. This dog, phenomenal. Built very nicely, not too big, not too small, very broad, nice bones on him, very nice open temperament, not nasty, but social and confident. You know, he nails the ball. I didn't get a chance to video this, guys. I'm going to video the next one for you though. So anyways, needless, crazy hunt drive. He's super possessive of the toy. You know, environmentals look good. Everything looks good. The bite work was what clinched it. He's a speed demon. He nailed me on the long attack. Showed no issues with the bite work at all. And for being clearly an inexperienced dog, I think he's 12, 13 months, something like that. Really, really strong, good potential, good dog. Anyways, so we did the x-rays on him. He's really nice. I'm still not sure what I'm going to call him. We'll see. But freaking really nice dog. Now, I'm on my way to see something special. Because I went and sat down. I'm glad the owner took the time to talk to me. I mean, look, at the end of the day, let's be realistic. I'm not a guy that's buying 30 dogs from him, okay? He's got clients that literally will buy 20, 30 dogs and handler courses and all that type of stuff. You know, I'm there for a few dogs. And not only that, I'm a bit of a difficult client because I'm looking for something special. So anyways, we sat down and I said, look, he's like, what do you want? I said, you know, you saw that first dog. I don't want, because they brought out a bunch of dogs after that first dog. And, you know, some of them were all right, but they just weren't enough for me. Like they were missing a speed, you know, and this, they were typical green dogs. There's, you know, I wouldn't say that they were shitbags or anything like that. They were good, decent green dogs, but they weren't special. And especially for me to buy a dog in Holland, I want only the best ones. I want the special ones. I want the ones that have that wow factor attached to their working quality. So he goes, I said, listen, a guy like you, you've got good ones. You have 300 dogs. You got this, you know, multi-million dollar facility. I know you got some gangster dogs. I know you got some real ones. Give me a real one. I like to always have a real one. Even though, you know, listen, the real ones aren't always the easiest dogs to sell, and they're definitely not the dogs for everybody. But I have a need to have strong dogs in my kennel. I need dogs that are showstoppers in their work. When people see them, they're like, holy shit, that's the dog I'm looking for.
All right, guys, this is a little floppier dog. I don't even know what this is, like a rat terrier. They use these for single purpose work. Very cute. They have a bunch of these little things. Super. Hey guys, so I'm at the Police Dog Center in Holland, and today what we're going to be doing is selecting a female, hopefully. One of my goals was to bring back a nice female Malinois. I'm not opposed to a German Shepherd as well, but I like to always have a female in the kennel that can work, because there's always a demand for that. So I do like to get my hands on a nice little female if I can. I have selected 5-6 dogs. I have to count. Really nice dogs. And I'm really excited. We've got a mix of dual-purpose police dogs, and we've got some nice executive family dogs as well.
Yeah! Yeah!
Back up. Very nice. Very good. Okay.
Hey, come on.
Good girl. Super. Better, has better environment than the other female.
Okay.
So I think we talk about this one then.
Okay.
Good girl. How old this one?
1 year.
Okay.
Los, hey! Out! Sit, 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 sit! Oh yeah! Hey!
Yeah.
Super.
Alright guys, so this is my lineup. We got Spinny Boy Enzo here. Enzo was just, he smoked everything. Environmentals, everything. We got Maddo. Maddo's a big, full purpose German Shepherd. He's really, really nice. And then we got Rico. Yeah, Rico. And then we got Yedin. Yedin was a super nice dual-purpose German Shepherd that we picked up. He's a real hammer. And then we got Little Sky. Anybody want a 45-pound Malinois? I couldn't pass her up. She was just such a little pocket rocket. Such a little, she has such a can-do attitude. Tough little girl. So I'm real happy with the lineup. Now this isn't all the dogs. Which Rico. And this isn't all the dogs. Come on, Enzo. Enzo, come here, you silly. Yeah, yeah. Good. That's nice. And then back. Ah, excellent. Good boy. Fucking nice. Perfect. Done. All right, guys. So that concludes the trip to Europe, or the dog selection portion of the trip to Europe. I am now going to go do some sightseeing. This is my last evening here in Holland, and then I'll be coming back to Canada. So I know you guys didn't get to see a lot of testing, and that's because my first priority was the dogs. I was doing the testing myself. I could not have the camera and the test at the same time. And again, I told you guys my priority is selecting the best dogs I possibly can. So I didn't want to take a chance of missing anything because I was focusing on the camera. So I got what I could. So you guys got little snippets here and there. I showed you around their kennel. That's one of their many kennels. So they have multiple facilities. They really actually do a lot of work. One thing, guys, please do not bother these people. They're really a B2B kind of business. So they service other businesses. They service other departments. They service governments. They're not really like, hey, I want one puppy, let me call these people. Or I want one dog, let me call these people. There are other vendors for that. They're more interested in people that are buying multiple dogs, you know, preferably customers that will be returning, so on and so forth. They're really a big, they run a very big, well-rounded operation, as you guys kind of got a little bit of a glimpse of. Fantastic stuff. Really cool to see the trainers there. Lars, who helped me out a lot. Arnold, you know, some others, right? Really, really good people to deal with. I really felt very welcome, and they were very hospitable and accommodating for all the things that I did. I'm sure they were like, what the hell is he doing sometimes? But that's okay. They went along with everything, and they were really cool to deal with. So one thing you guys saw was I did a lot of my first test. The first thing I did with the dogs was bite work. Okay, check the bite work on the dogs. The bite work told me a lot about the dog. That's my fundamental belief. It's not always the case. Nothing is 100%, especially when you're dealing with living creatures. But when I do my bite work test the way I do it, I learn a lot about the dog really, really fast. Now, of course, as with any test, it is a look at the dog on a particular day in a particular place, right? Things can change. The dog can get better. Dog can get worse, right? But we have a very short period of time to make a fundamental decision about the dog. So we do what we can to get the best profile we can of the dog. So what I like to do is the first moment of the test, I just approach the dog in a very slow and threatening manner. I have my hood up. I have my jacket on, so it changes my outline a little bit. There's no sleeve present. And I threaten the dog. And when I do so, I'm watching for a couple of things. Is he flinching? Is he forward on the leash? What's the behavior? Is he kind of avoiding me? Is he spinning and smelling the ground and doing all this nonsense? Or is he forward, 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 right? I'm looking for forward and confident and looking for an opportunity to engage me no matter what I do. If anything, I want to see him escalate when I escalate. So, and then after that, we take the heart sleeve. We give the dog a grip. And I'm feeling the grip in the sleeve. Is he munching? How is he reacting when I pressure him, when I drive him? I do my little high-pitched scream, little trick, right? About 10% of the dogs pop off the sleeve when they hear that high-pitched scream. And then I'll do, you know, some more auditory stress, some physical stress with the stick, whatever else. And I just check the grip and I see how's the dog responding. Is he biting me with intent, or is he just holding on, or is he in avoidance and trying to get away from me? What's the behavior like there? And then I find that most dogs, and I say most because not all certainly, but most dogs will fall into line with where they were, and that test will be kind of how they are with everything else. So the hunt drive, the environmentals, I find that the confidence that they had dealing with the bite work translates pretty reliably over to those other fields as well. Now, again, it's not 100%. There was a female Malinois. I really liked her in the bite work. We did open stairs, and she really struggled on the open stairs. I ran her up and down it like 3 times, and she just did not get better. So unfortunately, I had to wash her. Really nice female, but you know, again, short period of time to make a good to make a quick decision. We did end up with a female because it was important for me to bring a female back. Sky, she's such a cute little pocket rocket. You guys are going to really love her. And again, guys, I want you to understand, all these dogs, you're going to follow their journey in Canada. So don't worry. Even though you didn't maybe see too much of them here, you're going to see them in Canada. My goal here was to get the dogs, not really make videos. So I hope that helps. The Dutchie. Let's talk a little bit about the Dutchie. I bought a Dutchie. I know. I said if I ever buy another Dutchie, or if I ever say the word Dutchie, punch me in the face. Well, it's a good thing that, I think I've got a little head movement now. I know how to parry and block. So, you know, I think I'll be able to evade some of the punches coming my way. But regardless, I had to have the Dutchie, guys. I don't know why I bought him. Well, I do know why I bought him. Because when he was the best biting dog that I ran into here, right? So, he really mangled my bicep, as you guys saw. I'll show you guys in a second my bicep. But all right, guys. I'm going to share with you why I bought the Dutchie. All right? He really mangled my bicep. He was just such a hard biting dog. I didn't check anything else. I let him bite me for 1 minute. I pried him off. I had them pry him off my arm, and I said, I'll take it. Then I said, all right, you know what? I should probably see him on some open stairs. So we brought him in, checked the environmentals in their training building, which he wasn't staying in. Like, they actually brought him to the training building just to check. Ran him up and down those open stairs. He didn't love the stairs in the beginning, but he was willing to do them. And I always check out a drive. There's no ball. There's no decoy. There's no nothing. So ran him up and down once. And he did it. He was a little careful, but he did it. And then the second time, he was boom, boom, up and down. And I said, yeah, that's the dog I figured he was. No dog bites like that and shows that level of commitment and confidence and courage in the bite work, and then, you know, can't handle a set of stairs. It's very rare, or slippery floors or noises or dark rooms or anything like that. They can do, generally, if they bite like that, they're going to be able to do just about anything. So he's a really, really nice dog. Anyone looking for something a little bit special, a little bit of a gangster dog, a little bit of a top-tier dog, this is going to be one of those. So I had to bring him back. I like to have at least one gangster in the kennel at all times. Guys, I'm going to go do a little bit of sightseeing. I've really enjoyed my trip to Holland. I'm going to have to come back. But first, we got a lot of dogs to work through now, a lot of dogs to train. We got dual-purpose dogs. We got security dogs. We got family protection dogs. I'm real excited to bring all these dogs back to Canada and get started training them.